धियो यो न प्रचोदयात्। स्वामी दयानंद, स्वामी दयानंद द फाउंडर ऑफ आर्य समाज वॉज ए सोशल रिफॉर्मर। ही वॉज बॉर्न इन 1824 ड्यूरिंग द ब्रिटिश रूल इन इंडिया व्हेन मोस्ट ऑफ द पीपल वेर स्टीप्ड इन रिलीजियस इग्नोरेंस, सुपरस्टिशियस आइडल वर्शिप एंड पॉवर्टी। वीमेन were not allowed to have formal education. Caste system was prevalent with its evils, and members of scheduled caste were mistreated as untouchables. He stood against the hypocrisy of the priests and Brahmins of those days, especially those who exploited the society by misinterpreting the age-old scriptures of India to their own advantage and for selfish interests. Dayanand was a nationalist to the core of his heart and asked people to boycott foreign goods and Western style of living. He raised voice against child marriage, bigamy, and supported marriage of young girls who became widows in childhood. He was the first among the great Indian stalwarts who popularized the concept of Swaraj, that is, right to self-determination, vested in Indians when the British ruled India. Mahatma Gandhi derived much of his inspiration from Dayanand. Dayanand is considered to be one of the builders of modern India. His appeal was addressed not to the educated few, but to the Indian nation as a whole.
Asato ma satyamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya.
It was the night of Shivaratri festival in the year 1839. On the day of Shivaratri, people are supposed to stay awake all night and worship Shiva. Devotees from far and near had gathered at the Shiva temple in Tankara near Morbi in Gujarat state. They had fasted since morning and were superstitiously chanting the name of Shiva as a means of idol worship. By midnight, many of them began to doze except Mool Shankar, a 15-year-old Brahmin boy who later became Dayanand. He was determined to keep himself awake as he was a sincere devotee. He went on chanting Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, as others had been doing. To his surprise, he saw the rats eating away the offerings and even crawling over the deity. He tried to call his father and draw his attention, but his father was sleepy and asked him to keep on chanting rather than getting distracted by the rats. Mool Shankar tried to concentrate, but he could not. Finally, he got disgusted and left the temple, thinking, the idol who cannot protect himself from the pestering rats cannot be the Lord of the universe, and went straight to his home. Reaching home, he broke his fast. His mother did not have the heart to stop him. She compassionately said, "Mula, you have broken the fast before the dawn." Mula objected, "Mother, it is not that I am hungry to break my fast. I have lost my faith in the ways of idol worship. How can the idol be God when the idol cannot even protect itself from the rats?" Mula was confused. He could not sleep all night. He could not comprehend at his young age the philosophy behind the idol worship. As a teenager, he revolted. "Why should I do something simply because others are doing it?" He wanted to know the true nature of God. Next morning, when Mool Shankar tried to talk to his father for better understanding, his father, Karshanji Tiwari, was too busy with his official job of a tax collector called Tahsildar. Mula was disappointed. His uncle was sympathetic to Mula and affectionately tried to explain the idea behind idol worship. However, uncle's limited explanation could not satisfy Mula's curiosity. "I think it is foolish to worship an idol as the creator of this universe." 2 years later, Mula's loving sister died of cholera. Mula was shocked and confused. He wondered, "Is this the goal of life? Death?" His uncle tried to explain the immortal nature of soul and the concept of Atman, but he could not comprehend it. Mula, with time, became increasingly quiet, absorbed in his own thoughts, and was indifferent to worldly matters. He was curious to find the truth and get spiritual enlightenment. His mother was worried and reported to his father about Mula's loneliness. She happily said, "Maybe Mula needs to get married and the bride will make him happy." Father agreed, "I have a good proposal to consider and I will work towards this." In the meantime, Mula's dear uncle had an attack of cholera and he died too. Mula was shattered and wept bitterly. His father waited for a year and then once again started to negotiate Mula's marriage. He even gave word to one of the bride's parents. Mula did not want to get entangled in household matters and objected, "I cannot marry now." "But I have given my word," said the father, and the mother appealed, "It will hurt the prestige of the family. You cannot say no at this stage." Mula thought all night, "It is not what I want now. I must escape while there is yet time." He silently paid respect to his parents and ran away from the house in the middle of the night. He stayed away from the main road until he met a group of sadhus or mendicants. "I have renounced the world. I am in search of a guru," said Mula. "These were imposters and crooks," the leader said. "Then you should give away the gold chain. What good it is to you now?" Mula gave away the gold chain and the crooks were surprised. Later, he met a wandering monk who initiated him and gave a new name, Nastik Brahmachari, which means a lifelong celibacy who does not believe in God. The monk could not understand Mula's quest for spiritual knowledge. After this, he moved about wearing only saffron loincloth. He had not yet found his guru. Then one day, he met a fellow sadhu who informed that a big festival is going to be held in Sidhpur, where many sadhus will attend and he may meet someone to guide his spiritual growth. Mula decided to attend the festival. As he was getting ready to leave for Sidhpur, a sadhu who knew his father identified him. Mula also recognized the sadhu and tried to escape. He knew that his father would soon send the search party to catch him. It did not take too long for his father to get Mula. "Enough of this nonsense. You are coming back with me to lead a normal householder's life." He locked up Mula and placed guards until next day morning, when the party planned to return to their hometown. Mula wondered, "O God, is this the end of my journey in search of you?" He got lucky. The guards were asleep and the door was not locked. After running a distance, he realized that the guards will find him as they will come on horses and he cannot run that fast. He planned to climb a tree and stay there until the search is over. He was right. The guards nervously looked for him. "Where can he vanish? How are we going to face Tiwariji?" were their concern. He stayed on the tree all day next day and wandered through many pilgrimage centers of Gujarat. Then one day, on the bank of Narmada, he came across Swami Purnanand. Swami Purnanand was on his way to Dwarka with his disciples. Mula fell on his feet, begging to initiate him into Swami order. "But you are too young, my boy." But Mula insisted. After much entreaty, Swami Purnanand agreed to initiate Mula into the Swami order. "This cuts off your past status and relations," said Swamiji. "You are now a fresh born with a new name, Dayanand Saraswati. It means you take the delight of being compassionate. You will also take the vow that you will lead the rest of your life in spiritual thoughts." Dayanand accepted the condition with humility and Swami Purnanand blessed him. After staying with Purnanand for 2 years, Dayanand moved to Kashi, which was a great center of learning. Dayanand learned the art of meditation and yoga and practiced it for his peace and tranquility. Yet, he was distressed by poverty and the treatment of high caste people towards the poor people. Inside the temple, the Brahmins exploited the rich and discriminated the lower caste, which served them. He noticed a mother taking the clothes out from her dead child and throwing the dead body into the river, as she did not have the money to cremate his son's body. In desperation of the thought of people's suffering, he left for Himalayas in search of his enlightenment. For days, he wandered through the valleys of Kashmir without food or shelter. Finally, he fainted in exhaustion after starving for several days. When he came into his senses, he walked to the edge of a steep cliff and planned to kill himself. He had not yet realized his true self and the true nature of God. Let this body of mine perish on these high Himalayas. What good is it without enlightenment? Next moment he thought, my death in desolation serves no purpose. Why not use this body to lighten the misery of at least a few? Inspired by his spirit of service, he came to the famous Okhi Mutt, which shelters spiritual seekers. But here again, he found the seekers who had isolated themselves from the society rather than working for the society with a spirit of service. He was looking for a true guru who will be able to guide him to seek the eternal truth. He made no secret to express his strong opinion against idol worships in temples and practice of the Brahmins to exploit the society in the name of God. As a result, he created many enemies. Once two Orthodox villagers came to invite him to a temple to speak. Dayanand could not guess the trick, and when he arrived at the temple, his life was in danger. He was asked to sacrifice his life in front of the goddess Kali. But he was strong enough to overpower the priest and escaped. After this instance, Dayanand wandered for nearly 12 years in search of a true guru who will show him the path of salvation in the world of suffering. He was then only 36 years old. He finally came to a blind sage. Dayanand appealed, I have learned Sanskrit and read Vedas, and yet I am not able to find the truth, find peace and tranquility within myself. Can you help me? Throw those books, said the hermit. Try to realize the truth stated in these scriptures within yourself through meditation, said the sage. It is the ignorance about one's true self which is the source of all the misery and strife in the world. Dayanand was devoted to the Guru and stayed with him for 2 years. He served him with reverence. Finally, the Guru was pleased. You have learned all that there is to be learned. You are now fit to go out and teach others. Dayanand fell at the feet of his master and bid farewell. How can I pay you, O master? Asked Dayanand. Go and spread the message of the Vedas in the weary world. That would be most befitting offering or dakshina. Dayanand traveled from place to place, conveying the message of Vedas, which does not support idol worship, discrimination of caste, or right to learn about Vedas, irrespective of sex or birth in a low caste family. The conservatives opposed him, and the progressive society adored him. He became one of the leading social reformers, which were plaguing the Hindu society at that time. He gave sacred thread to the untouchables and to women. He explained the status of women in Vedic time. To acquire that honor, women must receive proper education, give up veil, and give up superstitions. Dayanand mixed freely with the untouchables and inspired them towards equality in the society. People of upper class despised him and tried to poison him. Dayanand, through his yogic practice, removed the poison by regurgitating all the food he had eaten. The tahsildar of the town, a Muslim by religion, had the culprit arrested. When he was brought in the front of the Anand for punishment, the Anand said, "Sayyid Sahib, please release him. I have come to set people free, not to throw them into bondage." The Muslim tahsildar was impressed. "Swamiji, you are the very embodiment of your name, Dayanand. The selfish ways and methods of the orthodox priests and Brahmins who claimed themselves as members of Sanatan Dharma were being questioned. They got alarmed. They decided to hold a meeting to stop Dayanand's popularity that was shaking up the Hindu community. It was decided that Dayanand would be invited to a conference in Kashi and debate with the learned Hindu pundits to justify his views. On October 22, 1869, a conference was held with Maharaja of Kashi presiding and attended by thousands interested public. 27 distinguished scholars were defending orthodox Hindu traditions, while Dayanand was a lone figure confronting them. Dayanand made the opening remark, "I can prove that idol worship is not sanctioned in Vedas. God cannot be contained in any form or image. I will also prove that caste as determined by birth have no Vedic sanction." After a long session, Dayanand silenced the opposition and the public was positively in his favor. The leaders of the Orthodox society could feel that their vested interest in exploiting the ignorant public was in stake. They came prepared to play a trick on Dayanand. One of them came with a long sheet of paper with a number of questions. He asked Dayanand to answer. "It's a lengthy one. Give me time to go through," said Dayanand. While Dayanand was busy going through the paper, one of the troublemongers approached the Maharaj. "He has no answer. He's just wasting time." Immediately the Orthodox supporters shouted, "Dayanand has no answer. Victory to the Sanatan Dharma. Victory to the Sanatan Dharma." Immediately, the hired rowdies broke up the conference before Dayanand could answer any of the questions. The Maharaja left the conference in disgust. People in favor of Dayanand came to him to lodge a complaint to the police. Dayanand replied, "What they did was out of ignorance. I bear them no grudge. In fact, I mentally prepared myself before starting my mission." Later, the chief pandits of Kashi came jointly to beg apology. They admitted, "What you say, Swamiji, is true, but we do not dare to go against age-old customs and traditions." Maharaja of Kashi later invited Dayanand to his palace. "Swamiji, please forgive me. I am impressed not only by your in-depth knowledge of your holy scriptures, but you are also a true seer. You bear no ill will even to those who persecuted you." Dayanand's reputation spread far and wide. Keshav Chandra Sen of Kolkata, who was the founder of Brahma Samaj, asked him to speak to his group. He later gave him a glowing tribute. He traveled widely, gave lectures, trying people to build self-esteem. Shame upon modern education, which fills you with contempt for your ancestors. During his tour, he befriended many Muslims. He ate food given to him with love and affection by anyone. This was quite a revolutionary idea in those days. In one instance, he spoke to the enlightened Muslim leaders. The Vedas belong to the whole mankind, for the truth is universal. So is God. Are we not all the children of the same father? When he was staying in Jalandhar, a city in Punjab state in India, Raja Bikram Singh came to see him. He was curious to see Swamiji's divine powers. He much hesitatingly asked, "I understand you are a celibacy. Can you show some of your superhuman feat of physical strength?" "Vikram Singh," Dayananji addressed, "strength is always good, be it mental or physical. But why do you want me to prove it?" Vikram Singh apologized and started on his way. Swamiji was standing by to bid farewell when suddenly he held the wheels and the carriage could not move. The driver whipped the horses and yet the carriage stood still. Suddenly, the driver and Vikram Singh noticed that Dayananji was holding the wheel to convince Vikram Singh of his strength. Vikram Singh was surprised and accepted his unquestioned strength. Swami Dayanand became increasingly popular and Arya Samaj became a leading organization bringing much needed social reforms. Halls were opened in different parts of the country and Swamiji's ideas filtered through to the common people. 2 years later, Dayananji went to Jodhpur to meet the Maharaja, who was his disciple. He did not like Maharaja spending time with a dancing girl, Nanijan. When Maharaja asked Nanijan to leave, she felt insulted and decided to remove the Swami forever from this world. The British government was very uncomfortable with Swami Dayanand because of his role in the rise of Indian nationalism. They sent 2 spies to Nanijan and bribed her heavily to poison Swami Dayanand. Dayanand was staying in Jodhpur as a royal guest. Nanijan influenced the cook Jagannath, and one day he mixed poison in the milk and served Swamiji in good faith. Swamiji got seriously ill. The doctor could not help. The cook could not bear his guilt. And one day he came to Dayanand to admit his fault. Dayanand pardoned him and helped him to escape. "Maharaja will not spare you. Run for your life." Swamiji's condition deteriorated and finally he left Jodhpur for better treatment elsewhere. The Maharaja, a devoted disciple of Swamiji, felt helpless. On October 30, 1883, Swamiji gave his last advice to his close associates. "Always remember that the truth will prevail. All else is transitory." And then breathed his last. At Tankara, a monument has been raised to the memory of this great, illustrious son of India. Dayanand's concept of dharma is based on full conformity with impartial justice, truthfulness, and the like, as embodied in the Vedas. Arya Samaj, established by Dayanand, is still today an active institution that contributes many social reforms in Hindus. It encourages women education, does not believe in caste system, and allows reversion to Hinduism for the converts. It also provides many public services and help to the needy. The Arya Samaj unequivocally condemned idolatry, animal sacrifices, ancestor worship, priestcraft, the caste system, and child marriages on the grounds that all these lacked Vedic sanction. Namaskar.
Asato ma satyamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya.